Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hi everyone, I'm Rosa and today we'll be doing 10 phrases to amaze native speakers. So let's begin! El español es divertido y fácil de aprender. Spanish is fun and easy to learn. El español es divertido y fácil de aprender. Spanish is fun and easy to learn. I think the pronunciation is very easy in Spanish. Yeah.
Aparte de saber español, también puedo hablar algunos otros idiomas. Apart from knowing Spanish, I can speak a few other languages as well.
Aparte de saber español, también puedo hablar algunos otros idiomas. Apart from knowing Spanish, I can speak a few other languages as well. Tell me which other languages you can speak. I can speak English, a bit of Japanese and French, but yeah, I have to study more.
Estoy aprendiendo español por mí mismo. I'm learning Spanish all by myself.
Estoy aprendiendo español por mí mismo. I'm learning Spanish all by myself. So good for you. Like, I know it's hard, but if you are, I don't know, if you are constant and you do something every day, I think you can also like learn languages by yourself. Like today there are so many resources on the internet. And...
Hablaré español como un nativo en 3 años.
I'll speak Spanish like a native speaker in 3 years.
Hablaré español como un nativo en 3 años.
I'll speak Spanish like a native speaker in 3 years. Oh, good luck!
He estado aprendiendo español por 10 años.
I've been learning Spanish for 10 years. He estado aprendiendo español por 10 años. I've been learning Spanish for 10 years. Yeah, I might have been studying English for longer than that.
Me tomó solo un año para hablar fluidamente.
It took me only 1 year to become fluent.
Me tomó solo un año para hablar fluidamente.
It took me only 1 year to become fluent. Wow. I admire you so much.
Gracias, pero en realidad no soy un hablante nativo.
Thank you, but I'm not a native speaker, actually. Gracias, pero en realidad no soy un hablante nativo. Thank you, but I'm not a native speaker, actually. Tell me your secrets.
Puedo memorizar alrededor de 50 palabras nuevas en español al día.
I can memorize around 50 new Spanish words a day. Puedo memorizar alrededor de 50 palabras nuevas en español al día. I can memorize around 50 new Spanish words a day. Wow, it's important to be constant. Yeah, just be sure to revise like the words you have studied before so you don't forget.
Puedo ver películas en español sin subtítulos.
I can watch Spanish movies without subtitles. Puedo ver películas en español sin subtítulos. I can watch Spanish movies without subtitles. I still use subtitles for English. Sé cómo conjugar todos los verbos irregulares. I know how to conjugate all the irregular verbs. Sé cómo conjugar todos los verbos irregulares. I know how to conjugate all the irregular verbs. Yeah, there are a lot of them, so that would be great if you knew how to did all of them right. There might even be Spanish people who cannot do that properly in some cases, so. This is the end of today's 10 phrases to amaze native speakers. So I hope you get the chance to use them. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. Bye. Yeah, I can. Teach me.
Hi everybody, Rosa here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, when are the prepositions por and para used? The prepositions por and para are a little difficult for Spanish learners because both are used in similar contexts and have similar meanings. In English, the prepositions por and para are frequently translated as for, by, and to. Let's go over por and para so you can learn how to use them correctly. Por comes from the Latin word pro, meaning for, while para is formed from the combination of the Latin prepositions pro and ad, which mean for and to respectively. Por is frequently used to express a cause, such as viajo por placer, meaning I travel for pleasure, a place, such as camino por la calle, meaning I walk down the street, a period of time, Por las mañanas voy a la universidad. In the morning, I go to college. A medium, te enviaré el paquete por mensajero. I'll send the package by courier. A substitution or equivalence, haré los deberes por ti. I will do the tasks for you. En passive voice, el almuerzo fue preparado por mi madre. Lunch was prepared by my mother. Para is used for. Utility, estas zapatillas son para correr. Meaning, these shoes are for running. Direction, voy para Europa en vacaciones. I'm going to Europe on vacation. Here, it can be replaced by con destino a, which means bound for. Time limitation, son 10 para las 5. It's 10 minutes to 5. Here, the difference is that we use para when time is fixed or when there's a deadline. Opinion, para mí que perderán el juego. I think that they will lose the game. Literally, for me that they will lose the game. And goal or destination, to where or to whom it goes, as in, saldré a caminar para respirar aire fresco, meaning, I will go for a walk to get some fresh air. Here, the goal is to get fresh air. The most challenging point may be to identify when to use por instead of para. Just keep in mind that por is used more frequently to talk about a medium to do something. As in, te llamaré por teléfono, I will call you by phone. Another common usage is to refer to something unspecific, either time or place. For example, estoy por tu casa, meaning I'm around, close to your house. Or llegaré por la tarde, meaning I will arrive around the afternoon. Para, on the other hand, is more often used to talk about the purpose or destination of something. As in, este libro es para la clase, meaning this book is for the class. Or voy para tu casa, meaning I'm going to or in direction to your house. How was this lesson? Pretty interesting, right? Do you have any more questions? Leave them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. Hasta luego, see you later.
Hi everyone, this is Rosa and today I'll be teaching you 15 ways to remember words, and these ways were submitted by fans. So let's start. A menudo veo vídeos en la televisión o YouTube que están diseñados para los niños pequeños. I often watch TV or YouTube videos that are designed for young children. Yeah, I think it's a really good way. Like, also when I want to learn a new language, like I watch some cartoons because they are always easier, and I think that really helps.
Aprendo sobre las raíces de las palabras y cómo las diferentes palabras se relacionan entre sí.
I learn about the roots of words and how different words are related to each other. Yeah, I think it might make easier if you know why the words are formed like that. So if you know that, you can then like form, know how to form the words and it, everything gets easier.
Asocio nuevas palabras con historias, juegos o películas.
I associate new words with stories, games or movies. It's always a good way to remember, like to associate things, like these mnemotechnical, I don't know, strategies. Like, for example, to remember kanji in Japanese, there are some books that relate like each ideogram with like a kind of story. So then you remember the meaning and everything. And it's quite useful. It works.
Asocio nuevas palabras con palabras que suenan similares en mi idioma natal.
I associate new words with words that sound similar in my native language. Well, this might work for some languages, but I don't know if this works for all of them. For example, Spanish and English, I think that would work.
Asocio palabras con dibujos, fotos y escenas divertidas.
I associate words with drawings, pictures and funny scenes. So yeah, I think this is more appropriate for what I said before, like the kanji, some of them you can kind of infer what they are, like what they mean. Like if you have like a drawing, like they are similar to what they mean. So I guess that.
Clasifico nuevas palabras con otras palabras relacionadas que ya conozco. I categorize new words with other related words that I already know.
Yeah, I think it makes it easier if you can, always if you can kind of classify and order things.
Escucho canciones y me aprendo las letras. I listen to songs and memorize the lyrics.
I think this is a really good way also. It's a way that you enjoy, like you like this, to listen to these songs and everything, so I think it comes to you like easier. You're not doing that much of an effort maybe, like because you're having fun.
Hablo tan a menudo como sea posible con los nativos del idioma. I speak as often as possible with native speakers.
Yeah, I think this is the best thing you can do. I mean, you can like read as many books as you want and listen to films or songs or everything, but to really learn a language, like you need to like speak it with native people.
Leyendo lo más posible, en especial el periódico, me ayuda a recordar palabras.
Reading as much as possible, especially the newspaper, helps me to remember words. Like if you see the same word like used a lot of times, like you get to remember that more easily than if you just have a, like a list of words and try to memorize every of them. And also you are seeing these words in a context, so you know how to use them and how they are used by the people. So it's a good way.
Soy persistente en la práctica diaria hablando con mi familia o con mis perros, a pesar de que no me entienden.
I am persistent in practicing every day by talking to my family or my dogs, even though they don't understand me. Why not? Well, you can also talk to yourself, right? But yeah, it's very important to be constant. I think it's like the most important point. Like you have to be constant to learn a language. You just cannot study it for a week and then, okay, the next month I will study a bit more. Like you have to be constant.
Trato de usar el lenguaje de forma cotidiana en el contexto de la vida cotidiana.
I try to use the language routinely in the context of daily life. It's important to try to use it as much as you can, I guess. Because sometimes you have to adapt the language depending on their situation, depending on who you are talking to. So it's important to know how you really use the language in your daily life, like how it changes on. Like not learning just by from some book, but learning it in like practicing in your day-to-day life.
Yo uso la repetición, leyendo, escribiendo y hablando las palabras una y otra vez.
I use repetition, reading, writing and speaking words over and over again. I used to do that. The only problem is that I normally forget like pretty quickly after that, but well, maybe there are some people that... Well, I guess if you do that in a constant way, like it's not like you repeat these words one day and then don't do that after that. Maybe if you do, if you go back to these words, like it can help you. I think it can be a good way then.
Yo digo palabras en voz alta para poder realmente escucharlas.
I say words out loud so that I can actually hear them. It's very important because sometimes we don't say them out loud and then we are kind of afraid to pronounce it. We don't really know how to do it, so it's nice to know. Even if you can, like, record yourself with a mic or something, so you can hear yourself talking and you can know, like, whether you are pronouncing it right or not.
Yo intento pensar en español para que se incorpore naturalmente a mi proceso de pensamiento.
I try to think in Spanish so it becomes natural to my thought process. Well, it's fine. It's like you're using Spanish in... during your day, so like if you're thinking in Spanish, you are also thinking in ways you can form new sentences and use the words you learned. So yeah, I think it's a good way. Like if you don't have anyone to talk to in Spanish, it can also be nice to try to like talk to yourself and make your sentences. And
usar tarjetas,
use flashcards. I have like some apps in my mobile phone, so especially to learn Japanese. It's really helpful. Like they show you new words and the translation. Then you get these flashcards repeat it, depending on whether you are answering them right or not, like they show you these cards more often or not. So yeah, I think it really helps to memorize words. So this is the end of today's 15 ways to remember words submitted by fans. I hope you liked it. If you have any other ways to memorize words, please tell us. And thank you for watching. Please don't forget to subscribe. Bye.
Hi everybody, I'm Rosa. Welcome to As a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, what are the main differences between Spanish from Spain, Latin America, and the Caribbean? Spanish is one of the world's most widely spoken languages. It's the official language in 19 countries, as well as in Puerto Rico. It's so widespread because of Spanish colonial history. During the colonial period, Spanish mixed with native regional languages, and that's why Spanish is so different around the world. There's no standard Spanish dialect, only regional dialects, so it's common for Spanish learners to run into different kinds of Spanish, especially in terms of pronunciation. In the US, Latin American Spanish is what's most commonly taught in schools. It's spoken in most of Central America and South America, including Mexico, and excluding Argentina, Brazil, Suriname, French Guiana, and Guyana. Latin American Spanish has strong R's and a relatively clean pronunciation. Words are pronounced mostly as they are written. Here are just a few regional varieties of Latin American Spanish. Caribbean Spanish often drops S's at the end of the words, making it sound a lot faster than Spanish from other countries. Mexican Spanish take a lot of vocabulary from the indigenous language Nahuatl. You may be familiar with the word chocolate, which comes from the word chocolat in Nahuatl. Also, the double L in Mexico has a Y sound, so my name is Ricardo is me llamo Ricardo. Colombian Ecuadorian Spanish is a mixture of Caribbean Spanish and Coastal Spanish. Here the double L usually sounds like a J, me llamo Ricardo. Argentinian Spanish is in a category by itself. It's very different from the Spanish spoken in the rest of Latin American countries. It has some indigenous Guarani vocabulary, but also French and Italian immigrants strongly influenced this dialect. An interesting fact about Argentinian Spanish is that Argentinian slang, called lunfardo, was originally a made-up prison language. Prisoners, mostly Italian, used it so guards couldn't understand what they were saying. Now, lunfardo words are used all over Argentina. Argentinian Spanish also uses vos, the formal you address, instead of tú, the more common informal address in Latin America. The double L is pronounced like a J or ZH, like in me llamo Ricardo. Spanish in Spain is called Castilian Spanish. Some pronunciations are very different than the other kinds of Spanish we've already mentioned. The double L is pronounced differently depending on the region within Spain. The Latin American CC is pronounced with a TH and sound like fi, fe. For example, gracias, meaning thank you, is pronounced gracias in Latin American Spanish and gracias in Castilian Spanish. Another major difference is that Castilian Spanish often uses the plural form vosotros instead of the form ustedes, which is used in Latin America. Pretty fascinating, isn't it? If you have any other questions, leave a comment and I'll try to answer them.
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hi everyone, this is Rosa and today we'll be doing the 10 phrases that make you look like a fool in Spanish. So let's begin. Es demasiado difícil, ni siquiera lo intentes. It's too hard, don't even try. Who says it's too difficult for me? I can do anything. Sky's the limit. No estoy lista para aprender español. I'm not ready to learn Spanish. Of course you are, don't say that. Just start, step by step. And you'll get there eventually. Yeah. No podemos hacerlo. We can't do that. Yes, you can. I tell you. Yes, do your best. Solo haz lo que digo. Just do what I say. Sorry. I will do it as I want it. Nobody has to tell me like how to do things. Nunca tendrás éxito. You'll never succeed. So sad that someone like tells you that, like, what do they know? Why should they put you down? Don't do that to other people. Be kind. Yo lo sé todo. I know everything. Yeah, that really makes you look like a fool. Yo no necesito aprender nada más. I don't need to learn anything anymore. Not true. You have to keep learning. There are always things to learn. Yo no necesito tus consejos. I don't need your advice. Listen to others. You never know. They might surprise you what they have to tell you. So just be open-minded and listen to them. And then if you don't want to follow their advices, you don't have to. But just be open. Yo tengo la razón y tú estás equivocado. I'm right and you're wrong. Even if you're right, you don't have to boast about it. You don't have to make another person feel worse about themselves just because you got something right. Because next time you might be wrong and you don't want them to tell you that you are wrong. So just keep that in mind. ¿Teníamos que hacer deberes? We did have homework. You should have asked that before. I don't know. Just carry a notebook with you and write everything you need to do. Okay, so this is the end of today's 10 phrases that make you look like a fool in Spanish. So, yeah, learn them, but try not to use them. I hope you liked it. Thank you for watching. And don't forget to subscribe. Bye. Chup, 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 chup. Rosa approved.
Hello, everybody. Rosa here. Welcome to As a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, how can you tell if a noun is masculine or feminine? In Spanish, every noun has a gender. That applies to plural nouns, too. Other Romance languages have masculine and feminine nouns, too. It's a trait that comes from Latin, and the gender can depend on its origin in an older Latin word. English doesn't have masculine or feminine nouns, so the easiest way to tell the gender of a noun is to take a look at the last letter of a noun. The general rule is that if a noun ends in A, it is feminine. For example, la manzana, the apple, la ventana, the window, and la casa, the house. Nouns that end in O are generally masculine. For example, el horno, the oven, el perro, the dog, and el libro, the book. The only thing is, there are a lot of exceptions. For example, el mapa, which is the map, even though it ends in A, it is masculine. And el día, meaning the day, which is also masculine. Some other examples are la foto, meaning the photo, which is feminine even though it ends in an O, and la mano, the hand, which is also feminine. Because there are so many exceptions, it's best to learn the nouns with their articles. These are the and a in English. For Spanish, it could be el or un in for masculine words, and la or una for feminine words. However, O and A are not the only indicators for masculine and feminine words. Here are a few others. Nouns that end in E, ma, or an accented vowel such as I are often masculine. For example, el perfume, the perfume, el programa, the program, el colibrí, the hummingbird, are all masculine. On the other hand, nouns that end in D, Z, or ion are normally feminine. For example, la felicidad, the happiness, la nariz, the nose, and la religión, the religion, are feminine. It's important to remember what gender a noun is because it sometimes influences other parts of the sentence they modify. Adjectives in particular change their spelling according to the gender of the nouns they modify. It goes a bit like this. A notebook, un cuaderno, is masculine, So to say a red notebook, you could say un cuaderno rojo. An apple, una manzana, is feminine. So a red apple could be una manzana roja, with rojo changing to roja, ending with an A. I hope that answers the questions. If you have any more questions, please let them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. ¡Hasta luego!